This morning, we're continuing on our theme for 2015. We're going to be, through this month, we're going to be staying on the theme of living the dream in 2015, and then throughout the year, about every month, we're going to have something going on that's going to go back to that idea of living the dream in 2015. And this morning, what God laid on my heart is He wants us to dare to dream. I want you to think about that this morning. Daring to dream. The Bible says in Psalms chapter 126, verse 1, when the Lord brought back the captive ones of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Those who dreamed. And this morning, I want to ask you, do you remember a day when you enjoyed dreaming? Stop and think about that. Dreaming. I mean, just this morning, I don't remember what it was I was dreaming, but my phone rang, somebody calling to say they weren't feeling well, and I had been awake, was ready to get up, and you know how the spirit's willing but the flesh is weak? And I thought, I'll just lay here for a second. And I laid there too long, and I was out, and I don't remember what it was I was dreaming, but something good was just getting ready to happen, and my phone rang. And I remember waking up thinking, oh, no. And then I couldn't remember what it was that was getting ready to happen, but it was something incredible because we can dream incredible things. I remember when I was little in school, I was the best daydreamer you could have. Now, anybody remember the story, the cartoon Ralph Phillips from Looney, I think it was Looney Tunes? He was a little boy that he goes into school, and the teacher starts teaching, and he starts hearing like Charlie Brown's wah, 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 and he just kind of zones out. And all of a sudden, you know, she says something about George Washington, and then he zones out, and he has got the axe, and he's chopping down the cherry tree.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
That was me. I was Ralph Phillips. While they say something about the Civil War, and all I had to hear was I think it was Hugh Glass was the guy's name in the Civil War, and all of a sudden I was gone. I was in the Civil War. I was rescuing people. It was a wonderful thing until I realized she was done talking, and she was right in front of me saying, "Are you awake?" And the whole class is laughing at me, you know. And I had that ability to dream, but sometimes as we grow older, we begin to lose that ability. And my question this morning is, have you come to a place in life where you're just living day to day? Have you stopped dreaming?
When Joseph was a little boy, he was driven by his dreams. God spoke to him, told him he had chosen him. When others didn't understand, Joseph still believed and trusted him, trusted and was willing to dream on. And
and dream? Have you sought God to say, Lord, what is the best use for my life? And this morning, God is speaking to us as a church. He is speaking to you right where you are. And he's saying, I want you to dare to dream. Father, this morning, I pray that you would help each one of us to recognize the importance of dreaming. Lord, to go beyond what this world would call to dream the impossible dream, but to dream the possible dream, that which you have laid upon our hearts. Lord, because with you all things are possible. In Christ, nothing is too difficult for you, Lord. Father, this morning, I pray in Jesus' name that you will break the bondage that has held us back, telling us that we cannot do it. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen us with the fact that we can do all things through you. Now, Father, I pray that you'll begin bringing to the surface those dreams. Lord, some of them are from the past that we've held on to but filed away. Some of those dreams that we've completely forgotten about. Lord, some of them are dreams that we have yet to dream. Now, Father, open the eyes of our hearts that we might clearly see. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we look at the Word, Psalm chapter 1, 26, as I read just a moment ago, when the Lord brought back the captive ones of Zion, we were like those who dream. God wants us to be like those who dream, those who have a dream, those who have that oomph, that we used to sing, remember that old song, Give Me Oil in My Lamp, Keep Me Burning? Give me oil in my lamp. We used to say, give me unction in my gumption. Help me function for the Lord. You know? We need that unction in our gumption. We need that strength. We need that newness. We need that dream. Listen to me. You can have all the excitement and all the enthusiasm, but if you don't have something to place it upon, it's just going to roll away. We've experienced that over the years here at Water's Edge. We'll get things going, and there'll be some excitement and some enthusiasm, but not the dream. It's just for the moment. And God says, I have more than just the here and now. I hold tomorrow in my hand, and I want you to dream about that fact and what I want to do in your life. Psalm chapter 126 again says, when the Lord brought back the captive ones of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with joyful shouting. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. We are glad. Restore our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. He who goes to and fro weeping, carrying his bag of seed, shall indeed come again with a shout of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. I want you to know that God has a purpose and a plan. In this scripture alone, as I was studying this, God kept causing old songs and people quoting parts from this. From my childhood up, how many remember that? Bringing in the sheaves. This is where it came from. We shall come rejoicing. What does that mean? That's what he's talking about here. We look at this and it says that they had laughter. How long has it been since you just had a good belly laugh? I mean, come on. Yeah, Dan, you laugh all the time. There's something about a commercial that came on. As soon as I saw it, I thought, oh, when Tish sees this one. It's a furniture commercial. And they're sitting on their furniture, and they're looking at their coffee table that isn't part of the new set. And they say, oh, it looked good until we bought this furniture. Now, and Tish starts tee-heeing, and then the guy goes, ah. And she just starts laughing until she's crying, and then it gets me laughing. And there's something infectious about someone that just lets go with a good laugh. And we need to grab a hold of that here. When we walk into a restaurant that's empty, people should be drawn to it, not even knowing why, because the power of God is in us, and that presence, and that joy. And I'll tell you what, I've grown up in the church, and I've found some of the most, just, what, mully grub, whatever, how, just the down, yeah, I'm here. Come on! With the joy of the Lord is my strength. His banner over me is love. He is a shield about me, my glory, and the one that lifts my head. We have so much to be joyous about. And we have so much to say, thank you, Lord. Yesterday, we got to go to Chick-fil-A. Somebody gave us a gift certificate for Chick-fil-A. I'm getting hungry just talking about it. And we went in, we got our Chick-fil-A, we went in, I like it, they've always got Christian music playing, it's a good atmosphere. When you walk into Chick-fil-A and you order, I have yet to have somebody say, what do you have? But you go into McDonald's, ba 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 ba, what do you want? If we went in, got over, I was excited, I get my Chick-fil-A, the people that serve me are happy. Nobody was coughing over my food. Ooh, this is going to be good. And I sat down, and as I was waiting to go sit down, there was a lady that broke out with a belly laugh. I mean, she just hee-hawed. And there was a seat right next to them, and just that's where we sat. And I sat with my back to them, and that woman, I don't think she took a breath. She talked so much. But then, as I was trying to listen to Tish, but you know when someone's talking and you just kind of, it's bouncing around, some of the foulest things I've ever heard in my life coming out of that woman's mouth.
Really?
Oh. And I thought, she seems so happy, yet from her what she's saying, she's so lost. And Christians that have Jesus Christ and have a hope of eternal glory, and have the blessing of God in their life, and we aren't that happy. What is wrong with us? We've stopped dreaming, and we're just living to get by. This psalm that I just read for you, the psalm is not attributed to David, which most psalms are. As a matter of fact, no one knows who authored this, and the reason is it was written many, many years after David had died. As a matter of fact, it was when they were released from the Babylonian captivity. Because verse 1 again says, when the Lord brought back the captive ones from Zion, we were like those who dream. We were like those who dream. As a matter of fact, the proclamation from the Roman Senate and General T. Quantius came at the Asmian Games, and I want to read to you what was proclaimed during the, there were like an Olympic game that was taking place. Everyone was there at the Colosseum. In walks the crier, and he cries out, the Roman Senate and T. Quantius, the general, having vanquished King Philip and the Macedonians, do ordain that the Corinthians, the Phocians, all the Lacretians, the island of Euboea, the Magnesians, Thessalians, Perabians, Achaeans, and Phthonians. Don't look them up because I'm sure I pronounced them all wrong. But these were all the people that were being held captive, among whom were the Jews, who had been living there for 70 years. They went on and said, after they pronounced all this, now imagine yourself, you're in the crowd, you're hearing this, it's clear as a bell, everyone is quiet and listening, says these folks shall be free. Oh my, we need something more than a woo-hoo. you're there for, you 70 years, you probably grew up there. There are probably very few people that said, oh, I remember when we were taken captive. They're probably dead and gone. And they've grown up and this is all they've known. And they hear, shall be free. Oh, wait, listen, there's more. And delivered from all taxes.
Yeah.
Hey, there we go. And live according to their own law. as you look at this, that was proclaimed. Evan, can you imagine an entire stadium? Have you watched the Olympic Games? This place was packed. It was standing room only. He gets out in the middle and quiets everyone down and shouts out, and somehow they all heard him. And he said, you are set free. You don't have to pay taxes. You don't have to live under our laws anymore. You are free. And what's the first thing that they did? It's documented. They looked at one another and said, what did he just say? You ever been there?
Yeah.
Wow. Are you kidding? What? I don't understand. This makes no sense to me whatsoever. What are they up to? What is going on? And they're looking at each other and they're asking, somebody, please tell us, what did he just say? And finally they had to call this fellow back in, put him in the center, tell everybody, okay, shut up and listen. And he said it again because they wanted to see it and they wanted to hear it again to make sure. And it was so incredible. They said it was like we were dreaming. It was like we were dreaming. And once, it's documented, once his proclamation was read, an incredible roar of joy came up and rose up with laughter and cheering. They were thrilled because they had been set free. And this morning, I want to ask you, how would you feel if whatever it is that's been binding you, holding you back, keeping you from taking hold of that dream this morning, how would you feel if you knew that was broken and it was gone?
Oh, gosh.
That's what God wants before you leave this place today. He wants you to be able to dream. Let's go back to that scripture. When the Lord brought back the captive ones of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongues with joyful shouting. Then they said among the nations, those folks, not just us that were delivered, but those that saw it, they said, the Lord has done great things for them. That's what God wants to do in your life. He wants you to have a life, the dream that is taking place, so that as you're going through your life, other people are saying, look what God has done in their life. That's what God wants. He wants to proclaim who He is by how He blesses you. God wants to pour that blessing. And they go on in verse 3 and says, the Lord has done great things for us. We are glad.
Amen.
And this morning, the only way that's going to happen is you've got to dare to dream. And what that means in code is you've got to trust God. You've got to trust God. You've got to dare to dream. Last Sunday night, I met with the young people. And we went through some, we're going through some exercises right now in the youth group. Here's what I want to do with my life. Here's the plan I'm laying down. Here's what God has spoken to me, and here's the direction I'm going. And as we talked about it, we discovered that we don't want to work at jobs that we hate. Anybody say amen?
Amen.
We don't want to work at jobs that we hate. We don't want to get up in the morning and think, oh no, got to go in to work again. We don't want to work at that job all day and then come home and do what we've got to do so that we can sit down and watch TV and watch that until it's time to go to bed, and that's our life.
Yeah.
Listen to me.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I've mentioned before, a ministry that I began doing is Chris Schettinger Funeral Home. Whenever there's somebody that doesn't have a minister in the vicinity, they call me up. And I feel like, hey, what better way to reach the lost than to go into a family that has no church affiliation whatsoever and show them the love of Jesus? But I'll tell you what, it is tough. So often, with someone I don't know, I've never met before, and the only information that the family will give me is the obituary that says they like their dog and they worked for 50 years and they enjoyed retirement watching TV. That's not living the dream. That's just getting by. And how many of you know God didn't send his son to die for us so that we could just get by? He spent that precious life of his son. I'll be honest with you, I don't get it. I don't understand it. I love you folks, but if one of my children were standing here and the rest of you were standing there and I had time to rescue all of you or them, you better be ready to meet your maker. I'm just going to be honest. That's my heart. Even Stephen, you know, believe it or not.
I think all parents would feel that way.
I hope so. That's why I can't understand why God would be willing, how he could love us so much that he could give his one and only son. And I can't help but believe if he went to that point, it was for me to have more than a mediocre life, just surviving and just getting by, but for me to live the dream. And this morning, God wants us to live the dream. Verse 4 goes on. This was a little difficult. I had to do some studying to figure this one out. But the writer goes on and says, "Restore our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south." We've got to understand that Israel was not brought back altogether. There were different parts of the people of Israel in different places. And God was delivering them at different times. And so as these were released from Babylonian captivity and they were heading home, they began recognizing there are others who are not experiencing the dream that I am experiencing. And they thought it was important to add them into their prayer and their praise to say, God, remember those. Put us in captivity with them as we bond together with them in prayer to get them out. Help us to feel like we are still in bondage until we get our whole family home. You talk about what it is to dream. Those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. As they are going back, some of them, can you imagine the older folks, those that were 70 years old and had grown up in captivity and they finally received their release and they're heading home and they realize how much of their life had been spent in captivity and how little they had left at the end. It reminds me, I remember when I was a kid growing up, it's printed in my brain. Mark White, Brother Mark White, he was really... Folks in my family, a lot of them called him Uncle Mark because their family is so tight with ours. But Mark, he was an elderly fella. He had worked hard. He was all bent over, and he was kind of tiny anyways, and white hair, and he would get up, and he'd sing this song. He'd sit in the rocker, and he'd start singing, "Wasted years, wasted years, oh how foolish." As the song went on and discussed the fact of how he wished he could go back and do it over again because he wasted so much of his life just getting by. And finally at the end he says, turn around, there's still some time left. And these that are, they're heading back and they're mourning, they're reaping, or they're sowing in tears. Those wasted years, those that had died and never saw the freedom from their captivity, those that were still in captivity, and they're sowing in tears. But the Bible says, those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. And you may be at a point in your life right now, a point in time, where you feel like you are in tears and you wonder, why would I even sow the seed? I could eat it and just die. Remember that story of Job? He lost everything. Even to the point where his wife said, "Oh, just curse God and die. Get it over with, Job." Sometimes we get to that point. Maybe it's a physical thing. We just get so sick where we think, "Man, God, just let me die." We get to the point maybe with our families where we think, "God, why are we here? I don't know what to do. I don't want this anymore. We get to the point where some people are driven to the point of suicide, and they think that is the answer, when in fact that is a lie of the devil and takes them into a worse situation. We need to grab a hold of the fact that God, he wants to turn things around. It says, he who goes to and fro, weeping, carrying his bag of seed. Do you see the picture of this in your mind? Someone that's got the bag of seed and they're walking across this freshly tilled ground. They're hungry, but they see this seed, they can eat it, but instead they know if they will plant it and wait and just get by on what little they can, eventually something's going to happen. That seed is going to take root. It's going to grow. And they'll see some things take place. And that's part of living the dream. Let me tell you, anyone that has owned their own business knows what it is to go after equity in your business. To go without so you can build that equity. When we went to Wisconsin and the church said, well, we're glad you're here, we're excited, we're looking forward to it, we sure hope you don't starve, because we can't pay you. And I started a service master business, and for the first year I found out what it was to have stories about being in ministry and being hungry. We went back to Atlanta to visit, and somebody said, man, you've really lost weight, it's been good for you up there. And I thought, yeah. And I had some, I remember going to the bank one day, and it was, you know, I was 23, I looked like I was 16. And I was going into businesses telling them, give me your keys and your passcode so that I can get into your banks and your businesses and clean them at night. You know, finally things started breaking free, and I remember walking into the bank to make some deposits, and the girl looked at it, and she looked at me, and she said, do you own this? And I said, yeah, and she said, wow. And I thought, yeah, wow. You know, my old van that is on its last leg out in the parking lot, toting around in equipment that I hoped would hold up until I could make enough money to replace it. But slowly, as we went without, as we continued to pursue and the business grew, I went without sleep. How many of you know I do not like going without? I get mean. I get grumpy. And going without sleep and doing the work, and finally God blessed that business, but I was sowing in tears. There were times that I laid on my face before the Lord crying, saying, Lord, what did I do that you put me in this place?
Amen.
What did I do, Lord, that caused me to be here? Well, I could relate to Joseph and all he went through, you know. Matter of fact, I probably did a few things that caused me to be in problems. I made some dumb choices. But as I looked at this and spent time, but God, I want you to know that if you keep planting that seed instead of eating it up, as God invests that seed of the dream in your life, it will be revealed to you. You talk about what it is to dream. Listen to me. You've got to be tough to dream. I want you to think about that. You've got to be tough to dream. To look at what seems to be impossible and to know that it's attainable. To hold in your hands something that's broken and believe that with God all things are possible. Is that you, Dan? Somebody's. Oh, it's 8 o'clock. I should hear it coming from this direction. There we go. Don't call back. Okay. But you talk about what it is to dream. Once again, you've got to be tough to dream. You've got to be tough to follow through with that dream. I can tell you, you don't know the times that I've gone to a mailbox praying, God, something has got to be in here. Something that I'm not expecting. And I can't tell you the number of times I opened the box and nothing was there. And God spoke to my heart and said, you've got to trust me. Because there were times when I said, God, something has got to be here. And open the mailbox and find a check for $1,000 that I didn't know was coming. We've got to be willing to dream, and we've got to be tough and stand firm in that. To look at what seems to be impossible and know that it is attainable. to hold in our hands something that's broken and believe that with God, all things are possible. To see a situation somehow evolved into a monster and know that God has a plan to turn that situation into a solution to accomplish His will and to fulfill your dream. Listen to me this morning. God is not going to just lay it out and say, here it is, go dance around, you know, what was it, the Tiny Timmy's saying, tiptoe through the tulips. God's not going to throw a bunch of tulip seeds out, let them grow up, and tell you to dance around in the tulips. But He's got a dream that's going to accomplish great things for you and for your family. God has a plan to turn the situation around into a solution for your life and for mine. As I was putting this message together, God reminded me of an incredible man that has challenged me since I was a teenager. Even before I ever heard him, just the stories I heard about him challenged me. How many of you have heard me talk about Dave Reaver, my pastor's brother, Al Reaver's brother Dave? Dave, he went into the military. He was part of the Blackwater Brigade, something like that. He went in and he got all his training. He went over to Vietnam. They put him in charge of a little boat. He ran around through the marshes in the jungle. One day, as Dave was out there, and the other fellows knew he was a born-again Christian. They made fun of him. They looked up to him all at the same time. But one day, they were in their boat, and they're going through this water. As Dave looks ahead, he sees an area where they had had gunfire coming from the day before. And he decided he's going to make sure that no gunfire is going to come out of that bush again. So he pulls the pin of a phosphorus grenade that burns white hot, I don't know how many degrees, and he reared back to throw this grenade. And as he was throwing, he didn't realize a sniper had taken aim at his head. And that sniper's bullet came just in time to go through his hand, through that phosphorus grenade, and as it was going by his head, it exploded and blew white hot phosphorus all over him, knocking him off of the boat into the polluted waters. The boat that he was in settled upon him, pinning him underwater. He continued to burn underwater with that phosphorus. Once he broke free and came to the surface, they pulled him off to the side. They put him on a stretcher, and as they picked the stretcher up, he burned through and fell to the ground because he was still on fire. They wrapped him up in wet blankets. They put him on another stretcher. If I remember the story right, he burned through that stretcher. They finally got him out and they put him in the helicopter. As they're taking off with the helicopter, the medic is deciding what to do with his dog tag because Dave is obviously dead laying there in the helicopter. And he goes to stick them in his mouth, but the way he's burnt, it's difficult. He starts shoving them up into the roof of his mouth. When Dave lets out a scream hollering, "Medic!" scared the medic so bad that he just about caused the pilot to crash the helicopter. Dave said he was laying there thinking, "Great, we're going to crash. I'm going to be the only survivor." Dave goes on to a hospital. And in that hospital, he experienced many things. One of which, he saw beautiful young ladies coming in and standing next to the bed of burned soldiers, taking off their wedding ring, laying it down on the bed and say, "I can't be married to someone that looks like that," walking out. And he knew his wife, beautiful young lady, they hadn't been married long, was going to be coming through that door soon. And he was preparing himself. But she walked in, and instead of taking her ring off, she looked at the chart to make sure it was really her husband because she couldn't tell. And then she walked up to the bed and said, "Welcome home, Dave," and she gave him a kiss. As Dave laid there, he decided he was going to recover. He was going to fight. He was going to win. He was going to live whatever dream God had for him. It wasn't long he found himself in a hospital bed, laying there with all the other injured around him. He had a nurse and a doctor that were not standing very far from him, and they were looking at his file and his chart. And as they were looking, the doctor looked at the nurse and said, this Reaver guy, this is a bad case. He'll never amount to anything. And Dave knew that God had something for him, and he pulled out what he had stuck in him. He jumped up, and with every ounce of strength he had, he looked at them and said, I will be something. Of course, he was something. He was standing there naked. But he proclaimed, I will, no matter what you say, I am going to be something because God has a plan for my life. God has a dream for me to dream. And it's not enough just for me to lay in a bed and get by. It's not enough for me to survive. But I am going to be victorious. And I'll tell you what, Dave Reaver has touched the lives of more people in this country, I think, than many would say. He's right up there with Billy Graham. He goes to high schools. He goes to the auditorium. We had him here in Newark High School. They brought in the troubled kids. And Dave got up there and he began telling his story. And he was able to look at those kids. And it's amazing. You see that face. I remember the first time I turned the corner and saw Dave in the flesh. It scared me. I remember after I saw him, got used to him, spent time with him. I went to pick him up one day. I was going to take him to the airport so he could fly out of Mississippi back to Texas. I got there, knocked on the door. His son-in-law, Phil, said, he's not ready yet. Come on in. And Phil and I were sitting at the kitchen table. And Dave came walking out, and he didn't have his shirt on. He didn't have his wig on. He didn't have his ear on. He didn't have any makeup on. And I knew it was bad, but when I saw him then, after knowing him and spending time with him, it scared me again. But I'll tell you what, 2 minutes after he starts talking, you don't see those scars anymore. And when he looks at those young people, and he would say to them, yeah, my scars are on the outside. Yours are on the inside. People can see my scars. You see your scars, and you know where they're at. And he begins ministering to them. And I've seen some of the toughest guys just fall into tears. I've seen girls that just no one could reach would just hug him and cry and thank him for coming. He would then, you always follow it up with an evening rally. And they come and you see young people after young people getting saved. And now David ministering, reaching out to the veterans, those that are wounded in wars. He's doing an incredible job. He could have said, you know what? They're right. I'm not going to amount to anything. He could have given up and died right there. But he knew that God had placed a dream in his life. That God said in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I've made for you, Dave Reaver. Plans for your benefit and not for calamity, but to give you a future with hope. And this morning, I want you to know that God is saying to you, I know the plans I've made for you. Before you were born, God had your days numbered. He knew the plan he had for your life. He loved you, and he was looking forward to celebrating every moment of every day with you. God wants you to take hold of that dream. Verse 5 again, those who sow in tears shall reap joyful shouting. And I'll tell you something that most people, maybe he's made it more known, but when I was in Mississippi, Dave sat down at a meeting, a men's only meeting, and as we were sitting there, he said, I want to tell you, fellas, something. He said, it hasn't been easy. As a matter of fact, up until just a few weeks ago, and this was back in the late 90s, Vietnam was long over. Dave looked at us. He said, up until just a few weeks ago, I regularly considered blowing my head off because of the pain and the suffering, because of the memories, all that were taking place around me. He said, I just wanted to be free of it. He said, God has done a work in me. For all those years that we didn't know he was in such pain as he ministered to those young people, as I saw him minister, and the power of God and the anointing was there upon him. He was in so much pain that he could hardly stand. As he explained to us, you don't know what it is to walk into a store and have people look at you the way they do. You don't know what it is to pull up to a drive-thru and have someone look out the window and fall back in fear. But you sowed in sorrow. And God has continued to turn his life to the point that he's already begun. And how many of you know, not just in heaven are we going to reap rewards, but God wants us to receive rewards in this life. He wants us to rejoice. Those who sow in tears shall reap with joyful shouting. He who goes to and fro weeping, carrying his bag of seed, shall indeed come again with a shout of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. Listen to me this morning. You've got to dare to dream. You've got to go beyond the pain. You've got to go beyond the unknown. You've got to go beyond the weakness. You've got to go beyond the sadness. You've got to go beyond everything that gets in your way. You've got to know that God wants you to dream, and you've got to dare to dream. You might be there sitting there thinking, oh, Pastor, you don't understand. I've got nothing to dream. Maybe you're sitting there and you're saying, Pastor, I've just lost all my strength. Maybe they're saying, I fell asleep and the enemy stole everything away from me. I want you to know, here's what God is doing with those who steal from his people. Job chapter 27, verse 16. I made mention of this last week. I didn't have the scripture and verse, but this week, though he piles up silver like dust, this is talking about those that are wicked, those that steal from the people of God, though he piles up silver like dust and prepares garments as plentiful as the day, he may prepare it, but the just will wear it. Hallelujah. And the innocent will divide the silver. You talk about a great God. He says, they may prepare it, but my children are going to wear it. Hallelujah. As we look at this, there's more. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 26. For to a person who is good in his sight, he has given wisdom and knowledge and joy. While the sinner, he has given the task of gathering and collecting so that he may give it to the one who is good in God's sight. You've got to dare to dream. God has a plan worked out, and it's not just for the person next to you. Listen to me. God has a plan for you. And he wants to work through you. And as he works through you, he's got a plan for the person next to you, and he wants to use you to reach that person. If you have the joy of the Lord in your heart, you have got to dare. But what keeps us from dreaming? That's what I was asking God this week. We'll get to it. What is it that keeps us from dreaming? God has a plan and a purpose. And he wants us to dream. And far too often, we choose our preference over our passion. I want you to think about that. As I've mentioned several times before, when I was a juvenile probation officer, I wouldn't let kids off probation until they wrote something telling me this is what I want, because I am determined that we get what we really want. If you want to be a doctor, then you're going to study and go to school, and you're going to become a doctor. And maybe along the way you find something that you want more in your studies, and you change your career choices, but you're going to follow what it is that you really want. And if you want to sit on your behind and work a remote control, you're going to do that. What is it that you want? And we follow too often our preference instead of our passion. I was faced with this at our Assembly of God Ohio Network meeting last spring. Brother Wood, our general superintendent, came. I figured if a guy is a general superintendent of the Assemblies of God around the world, which is millions of people, he probably has something to say. But how many of you are like me and you don't trust politicians? And I wondered, is he a politician or is he a man of God that's going to bring the word? He got up and one of the statements he made was, he said, I was at a meeting. Worship was going on. And they were going after it. And God was moving and I was enjoying it. And then they went to another song that just was not my cup of tea. He said, I thought to myself, why would you do that? You ever been there? Why would you change? Maybe you've done that, but I've been to you. What's wrong with you, Pastor? Why would you do that? He's thinking that, and all of a sudden, out of the corner of his eye, he looks over and he notices grandson who's standing next to him, going after God like everything. And God spoke to his heart and said, you're looking at your preference, his passion. And you're allowing your preference to determine what his passion is. Well, if that's not bad enough, you're allowing your preference to even determine your passion. And the reason we don't dare to dream is because we want to stay with our preference. What's comfortable? What's relaxing? And I know, there are times I get home and there are things that I need to do. And it's my passion. You know, for those of you that have been out to the house, people thought we were crazy. Why would you buy a 100-year-old farmhouse? And I'm loving it. I'm learning things I never knew before. I can plumb. And it don't bleed much. And I'm discovering some passions there that I never knew I had and some of the things I can fix and enjoy. But there are days when I get home and I'm thinking I need to go down and work on that. But my preference is to sit in the chair. And then I have to ask myself, am I going to let my preference rule my life? Or am I going to go after my passion? And that's what God wants to know this morning. Are you going to let your preference rule your life? Are you going to come to an end and have your obituary read in two sentences? Or are you going to stand in the presence of God and hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You pursued your passion. You pursued the dream that I made for your life. You touched people's lives. You've been faithful over a few little things. Life. I'm going to make you a ruler over men. And then God's going to look at us and say, enter now into the joy of your Lord. It's all about preference, passion. God's plan is that your dream ignites your passion. Acts chapter 2, verse 17 says, and it shall be in the last days, God says, that I will pour forth of my spirit on all mankind. Listen to me. As the passion of God pours out not just into us in a service on a Sunday morning where we can leave and say, woo, we touched God. I can't wait till next Sunday. He says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. On all mankind, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Lord, I want to see my kids prophesy. I want to see them. I want to hear. I'm like those folks that are in the Colosseum, and when I hear them prophesy, I want to say, what was that? Someone do it again. I want my kids to, your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. Amen. I want a church full of and Licking County. I've got a vision that goes beyond Licking County. God is pouring through me. I want to see the young men. And it says for us older guys, I know that I'm over 50, I'll put myself there. And your old men shall dream dreams. How about it, orphans? Are we dreaming? Are we living day to day? Even on my bond slaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, and blood and fire and vapors of smoke. Those of you that saw the Sunday school that we had on the blood moons and seeing all the information coming in on what God is doing, He is fulfilling what He said He was going to do. It is taking place. And by the way, an advertisement, you need to come Wednesday night Bible study. Did you find that? Okay, this Wednesday night, we're going to start back up. I had so many people say, I want to see that again. There was too much information. I didn't get it all. And Wednesday night, for the next month, we're going to be going through the study on the blood moons, because we are in a time, and listen to me, God is either using this to say, wake up, church, there are things that I want to do through you, or He's saying, wake up, church, it's done. And God wants us to understand that He is in the midst of fulfilling this scripture. Even on my bond slaves, both men and women, I will in those days pour forth of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will grant wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come.
Hallelujah.
And if that doesn't get your motor running, verse 21, and it shall be that for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, they will be saved. I don't know about you, but I want to be part. I don't want to be reading about this in the news. I want to be telling the news people what's taking place. I want to be living the dream. And as I mentioned previously, one of the ways God spoke to me was, I was in a meeting. I don't remember what they were talking about. But they said, we want you to pray right now. God wants to speak to you. What's He speaking? And I did my pastoral thing. Oh, dear Lord, you know my heart. Then I got quiet. And God spoke to my heart and said, you've stopped dreaming. And He put me in a box. Maybe you're here today and you would say, talk about someone that can dream. If you're hearing those voices over there, our kids are having a ball back in Children's Church. They can dream. We need to make sure that we are dreaming the dream ahead of them, or we find ourselves crushing their dreams. God wants to use our dream to lay it all out so that their dreams can come through true, and they can come in and what we've laid a foundation for, they can build upon. But we've got to dare to dream. And all week long, I struggled with God, Lord, what do you want for altar call? And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm still struggling. for some here that realize they've been dreaming the wrong dream. I probably need to make that part of the series. But you don't need to wait for a message to come about dreaming the wrong dream to allow God to correct your dream. Sometimes we fall into a stupor. And we lose our passion. And then we find our passion in the wrong thing. Sometimes it's not even a bad thing. Sometimes it is. This morning, you cannot leave this place and continue in that wrong dream as God has revealed it to you right now, because that would be rebellion against God, and the scripture says rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. I would encourage you right now to repent. Surrender to God, and the word repent means to turn and go the other way, to leave that thing completely. That's a word from the Lord. And as we're here today and we're struggling with preference and passion, Father, this morning, I pray in Jesus' name that you will cut deeply into our lives. Give us a porthole to look in and see beyond preference, to see beyond selfish desire, to see beyond laziness, to see beyond busyness. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that we will see deep into the passion of our lives. And we will take hold of that passion. Father, I pray that you will help us to pull that passion to the forefront and begin opening it up as we would a book or a map. Help us to open it up and look at this, the passion that you've given us. The passion, the plan for this life, the dream that you want us to dream. Lord, help us to discover the starting point of that dream from this moment. And Father, help us to step into that dream and to put together an action step. Lord, that first step that's going to take us into the dream. Help us to put together a plan that's going to cause us to move. And Father, I pray that you would help us today to determine accountability. Those that we're going to bring into our life to show them our passion, to show them the dream that you've given to us. Lord, that we would lay that map out before them as you direct us and explain to them the steps that we're going to take, and then give them the responsibility of holding us accountable and the authority. Father, don't let this be another message that touches us but doesn't change us. Father, that this would bring us to that point that we would never look back. Your word tells us when you put your hand to the plow, don't look back. Now, Father, I speak the blessing of living the dream this morning. I speak the blessing of having a plan. I speak the blessing of going beyond the mundane of this life. I speak the blessing of living passionate. I speak the blessing of letting go of prayers. Father, in Jesus' name today, I speak the blessing of a plan and the blessing of accountability as you're speaking that to our hearts and lives, as you're putting legs and arms on that plan so it can move and breathe. Father, that we would never, ever be the same again. Lord, I speak that blessing upon each one under the sound of my voice, that they would walk in that blessing in us. I speak that blessing of a life and life more abundantly. I speak that blessing of living a life that invests itself in our children, in our families, in our neighbors, in our friends. A life that makes you smile, Father. I proclaim it is done. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that we will respond to you in such a way that you would bless us and be gracious to us, and that you would cause your face to shine upon us. Not only today, we would live with a passion. We would live the dream every moment of every day. In Jesus' name. Everyone who received that said,
amen.
Amen. I want you to live the dream. I want you to take a hold of this. I want God's glory to be revealed in you. Never did come up at the exact altar call, at least that was there. But I would ask that you have your altar call in your prayer closet today. This has been our week of prayer. I hope you got some good habits that we'll have our month of prayer and then our year of prayer, 2015. I want you to find your prayer closet. Get along with God. And begin asking Him specific questions about the dream that He wants you to live. And I want you to begin putting together action steps and an action plan of how it's going to be done and who you're going to bring into this so they can hold you accountable. Because if you don't do it, let me tell you from experience, it's probably not going to get done. And God wants to do incredible things in and through you. Lord bless you. Don't forget about Captain's Table and Youth Group tonight. We're going to have an incredible time. Lord bless you. Have a wonderful day.